Well, if you have your Bibles open to Matthew chapter 6, we will continue moving through the Lord's Prayer that we just recited. And my hope and my prayer for this series is that they are not just syllables that we know by heart, but truths that are known in our hearts. In particular, we've been looking at the last 3 weeks at the three petitions that are made at the very beginning of this prayer. We've been looking at those three petitions as such that sometimes we can read them not so much as petitions, but as things that, you know, go ahead and you do this, God. Like, you know, hallow your name, God. And it's important for us to see them as encouragements for us to participate in the living out of those requests, and that we're praying to the one who can enable us to do that. We've looked at the petition to God the Father that his name be hallowed, that his name be reserved, be set apart for special use, be honored as holy. We looked at the petition which follows that, which requests that his kingdom come. And again, I don't know how often we rightly weight that request. Weight being W-E-I-G-H-T, that God's kingdom would actually come, recognizing that for the moment this world lies in the hands of the evil one, as the Apostle John tells us, but that God is spreading his gospel message of hope and healing to the world, and doing so through you and me. And last week we examined the petition that we desire, that the Father's will be done. Seeing through the pages of Scripture, God's holy writ, that since the fall of mankind, and falling meaning to sin in the garden, God has been providential in both bringing about the knowledge of his Son and in calling people to repentance and faith in him, through means by which we may not even enjoy, because sometimes it's uncomfortable as we suffer, even in this life. And there are two main applications for those petitions, two main ways we need to view them that we often don't, because they have become such a part of our repertoire of spiritual sayings that we just memorize them and say them. But I want to remind us that those two main ways we need to view them is, first being that while these are petitions, they are requests of sorts that we're making to God, that we are not asking God to just press a button and make them happen out there. Oh God, hallow your name to them. And push a button, God, and make your name be hallowed. All of a sudden, may blasphemy laws come back into place, and may his name not be just dragged through the mud by the world. We're not petitioning in that way. These are actually petitions that serve as a call to God to help them to be real in our own lives. I often read or recite this prayer in such a way that I want everyone else to be really better at hallowing God's name. Like, Lord, please help Lincoln hallow God's name better. Boy, I wish Joe would hallow God's name. No, the petition is for me. Yes, it's our Father. Yes, it's a collective prayer, but I am saying, God, work first in my heart. Help your name to be hallowed in my heart so that my affections and my desires are honoring and pleasing to you. These are not out there petitions. They are in here petitions. So that's the first main application. These petitions are requests for change in our own lives. And the second application is one that Jesus gives us in the last part of verse 10 of this prayer. And when we think about this prayer, as Jesus is leading up to it, and as he begins to give them the actual words for this prayer, he says, beginning in Matthew 6, I'm going to start reading in verse 7, leading up to this, and this kind of gives us an idea of the condition of which these petitions are asked. Verse 7 of Matthew 6, and when you pray, do not heap up empty phrases as the Gentiles do, for they think they will be heard for their many words. Verse 8, do not be like them, for your Father knows what you need before you ask him. These aren't news bulletin items for God. God, you may not have heard. No, he heard. Verse 9, Jesus then says, pray then like this. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name, your kingdom come, your will be done. So those three petitions, hallow your name, set it apart, your kingdom come, may you come in power and in authority and rulership. Your will be done. May Father, your will be done beginning in my life, but in this world. And he says to close those petitions out on earth as it is in heaven. And you don't need to make a request for something that's already the case, do you? Like, oh God, like right now I could pray. Boy, I sure hope that Hope and Luke show up this morning. Like, they're right there, Mike. Thank you, Lord. We're not praying for something that's already happened. We're not praying for a state of being that's already there, are we? I mean, otherwise it's kind of a foolish request. Like, oh God, thank you for keeping the lights on this morning. I hope you keep them on during Sunday school, which happened 15 minutes ago. We're not asking for something that's already happened. We're asking for a change to be made. And by way of petition, it begins in our own hearts. And he's saying that we want his name to be hallowed. We want his kingdom to come. We want his will to be done on earth as it is in heaven, which means there's a model for that fulfillment. That's a prayer that's dangerous. It's a prayer that says the nature of this world that we live in today is nothing like what heaven will be. Thank you, somebody. I'm guessing Elaine's in the nursery, because I thought I'd get her on that one. I thought she would be the one, but thank you, Kathy. Yes! This is a dangerous prayer because this world, even as good as it is not the way that it will be in heaven, nor the way that it is right now in heaven. And we're asking for a heavenly condition to be here on earth. And sometimes I wonder if we truly measure in our own hearts and minds what that will be like. Because in heaven, God's will is accomplished to perfection. And we know that since that ancient serpent was expelled from the spiritual abode and took a third of the angels with them, we see that in Revelation 12, that the inhabitants of heaven have sought only and completely for the praise, honor, worship, and glory of the Lord. Am I ready to make that same request of God for my life now? That's a challenging thought. Am I willing to set aside my wills and my desires? Am I willing to submit? And that's probably why it's challenging. That's a four-letter word no matter how you spell it in our world. So you can't submit. Oh. Am I willing to submit my will to God, come what may? I don't know if I am. I want it. I can give lip service to that. But is my heart there? The natural answer, of course, is no. We're still battle sin each and every day. That's why those first three petitions are there. We must give active thought to the fact that we're asking God to use us to demonstrate a heavenly obedience to his perfect name, to his righteous rule as true king, and as we bow our lowly knee to his perfect will in accomplishing that great commission. That's challenging. And I can tell you, growing up in the church as a child, getting back to church as God saved me in my right around the marking of my completion of my third decade of life, that I have said the Lord's Prayer probably over 10,000 times in my life. But have I given that thought? That I'm asking God to have me be obedient as they are in heaven. And part of that comes from our conception of heaven, too. Because we can have the conception of heaven that I will have everything I want as my wants are here in heaven. Because you will have everything you want in heaven. But your wanter, as Chuck Swindoll would say, it might have been Adrian Rogers. Your wanter will be better. Our wanters are broken, but your wanter's going to be fixed in heaven. So you will have everything you want, but we don't even know what that will be like because our wanters are broken here. And sometimes our broken wanters can bleed into our conceptions of what heaven is. And we've talked about that a lot here, so I won't go down that road. But I'm thankful for that fact that as we pray this prayer, we're actually asking God to do something mighty and very transformative in our hearts and in our lives. I was greatly blessed this past week in my study to read from J.I. Packer, who makes this critically important point that I think helps us to understand this final condition upon which we're asking for these petitions to be fulfilled, his name to be hallowed, his kingdom to come, his will to be done, that condition would be on earth as it already is in heaven. So it's a reality in heaven, and we want that to come to earth, that it is a condition that is based upon hope. It's a condition that's based upon hope because it's not that way here. But it will be someday. Packer explains that the phrase, on earth as it is in heaven, makes a declaration. It declares God's power and his greatness to accomplish his purposes. That's hope. The fact that God will not fail. That every single one of his promises will be yes and amen and fulfilled. It's a hope that you can trust everything that he has promised. Because he is so mighty. He is so great. Thinking about it in regards to hope that helped me ground those petitions, in my own life. I can look out like you and see a world in which the Lord's name is tragically dragged through the mud, both in casual usage in the general populace and by the actions of those who claim to be his, starting with the mirror, starting with my own life at times. I can look out and see, like we had already mentioned, what the Apostle John tells us, as the world still lies in the power of the evil one. I can look out and see that and just be dismayed. I can look out and see his kingdom and the kingdom of Satan at continual odds. I can see the kingdom of Satan making advances, and I start to wonder what is truly going on. And I'm not talking about the back alleys of the drug-riddled areas of our worlds and the senseless violence that gets reported on every minute of every day. You can turn on your internet and find it. I can see these two kingdoms on my ballot, even as I prepare to vote on Tuesday, polished up and looking pretty. Like we sometimes get the conception that evil is only evil if it looks really terrible. You know, that meth lab, evil. Somebody caught into the lies of addiction and the lies of Satan and trying to get others caught into that lie. We get that idea. We get the idea that evil or Satan's kingdom or the power of the evil one looks like somebody just drunk and passed out and vomiting in the gutter. And that's evil and that's terrible. It is. But how often do we truly recognize the evil that we can even see that polishes itself up like a politician? It can polish itself up and write Propaganda 3, which says that babies deserve to die and parents have no rights. And children, who we don't allow to drink till they're 21, vote till they're 18, serve in the army till they're 18, drive until they're 16, can make life-altering choices at the ages of whatever. The people that wrote that probably shaved in the morning, brushed their teeth, put on a suit, went to an air-conditioned, professional-looking office. And came up with one of the most disgusting pieces of legislation that's ever been proposed. How often do I view that as evil? How often am I prepared to call that what it is? How often do I find myself getting nervous for Tuesday? How often am I going to check my phone Tuesday night, Wednesday, or like a week later, because we won't know? Because with all this technology, we find elections harder to do now. Or do I pray, your name be hallowed, Father, beginning here. Your kingdom come, Father, here, beginning here. Help me to submit to your kingdom, Father, come what may. Help your will to be done starting here in my heart. Come what may. On earth as it already is in heaven. So I can get really good at looking out and seeing the hands of the evil one in the obvious places, but sometimes we have to look a little closer, and that's to say nothing of even examining our own hearts and longing for the day when temptations are a thing of the past. Because as disgusting as Propaganda 3 is, my sin stinks with a wretched, putrid awfulness in the nostrils of God. Do I have that same standard for nasty that I have for out there as I have for my own heart when I give way to temptation, when I get angry without just cause because I have pets and kids? How often do I actually have that standard for myself and say, God, start here. The heart can be an idol factory. Shut it down. Make it as it is in heaven. And I thought it would be helpful for us this morning to spend some few moments anyways looking at some instances where heaven, that plane of glorified existence reserved for the Lord alone and those to whom he offers entrance, what does that look like on the pages of Scripture? What do we see when we see angels offering unadulterated praise to his name, or we see deceased saints alive as never before in front of the throne of God, worshiping his holy name and singing hallelujah? What does that look like for us? If we want what's in heaven to actually, what is in heaven, it's a present reality. It is actually literally going on now. If we want that, how can we model our own hearts after that shocking scene? And I want to start in Isaiah 6, and not just because this is one of Abram's favorite passages, and his older brother's name is Isaiah. I thought that was great. Like, that alone means that Abram should find another verse, but you can't let your older brother be the title of the verse, the book. But in Isaiah chapter 6, God gives Isaiah this shocking scene, and we've read this many times here. It's one of my favorites. You guys know that. As you guys are turning, I'll start reading the verses that lead up to it. But in Isaiah 6, verse 1, Isaiah writes, "In the year that King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord." And I could stop there. Can you imagine that in vision form? "I saw the Lord sitting upon a throne," because he's king, "high and lifted up. And the train of his robe filled the temple." Oh, the majesty of that scene, even as you let your imagination soar into that heavenly abode. Verse 2, "Above him stood the seraphim. Each had six wings. With two he covered his face. With two he covered his feet. With two he flew. And one called to another and said, 'Holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts. The whole earth is full of his glory.'" That worshipful scene, that God's train fills the temple, the majesty of his very being fills the temple, and he's high and lifted up because he's king, he's the ruler, he's sitting on his throne, and these angelic beings with six wings hover around him and sing praises to his holiness. How often in my heart do I view his holiness as being praiseworthy? Yet without it, we're lost. Three times, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord. The whole earth is full of his glory, and the foundations of the thresholds shook at the voice of him who called, and the house was filled with smoke." Even at this vision form that Isaiah is given, even as the Lord speaks from his throne, smoke fills the house of the Lord. "The foundations shake when the Lord speaks," verse 5, "and I said, 'Woe is me, for I am lost, for I am a man of unclean lips, and I dwell in the midst of a people of unclean lips, for my eyes have seen the King, the Lord of hosts.'" Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. blah-diddy-blah-diddy-blah, we can go in our hearts. But may our hearts soar into the throne room of God, because just a glimpse in vision form of God's holiness to the prophet Isaiah caused him to fall on his knees and say, "Woe is me. I am unworthy to even see in vision form the throne room of God filling with smoke, trembling and shaking at just the proclamation of the words of the Lord." Our Father who art in heaven, and it's not just a recognition of the difference, the transcendence, the holiness of God and our sinfulness. That distance seemingly uncrossable by the prophet Isaiah is like, "Woe is me. I can't even stand before the Lord, even just with a vision." He recognizes his lack of holiness and the Lord's pure holiness. Verse 6, "Then one of the seraphim flew to me, having in his hand a burning coal that he had taken with tongs from the altar, and he touched my mouth and said, 'Behold, this has touched your lips. Your guilt is taken away, your sin atoned for.'" It wasn't just Isaiah that was aware of the gap, the uncrossable chasm that stands between the holiness of God and the prophet Isaiah. It wasn't just Isaiah that recognized that gap that's there. "I can't even come near you, Lord." It was also the Lord. And he provides that way to be in his presence with your sins atoned for. Isaiah recognized his sinfulness. "I'm a man of unclean lips." God says, "I've atoned for that." The angels didn't even see it possible to touch that atoning sacrifice. With tongs, they grab. Beautiful. They take that from the altar, the burning coal. They touch it to his mouth. "Your guilt is taken away and your sin is atoned for." That's heaven. That perfect, untouchable, holy sacrifice of God, being Jesus Christ, his Son, sinless and perfect, has taken away your guilt, and your sins have been atoned for. And by that are you brought into his presence and able to revel in the glory of his holiness. Let your imagination soar into what that will be like. The one who breathes all of creation into existence and upholds it by the power of his word says, "Come." Do you see that Isaiah didn't even clean himself up? Like, he didn't run around going, "Well, I better go take a bath. I gotta put on my perfect priestly garb." No, he was like, "Woe is me. I'm a man of unclean lips," and God says, "Your guilt is gone. Your sin." That's heaven. We aren't there because you were so great that God, that heaven wouldn't have been complete without you. You're there based upon the mercy and grace of God and him alone. He bids you come. And then provides the way. That's an amazing scene of heaven. Angels in perfect worship, honoring the Lord, recognizing him for who he is. And I love the book of Revelation, not because it confuses me entirely, in a good way. Points me heavenward. Uses images that I can't even sometimes imagine in my head, but there are some that I can understand, and there's some that my mind can wrap around a little bit, and one of those is in Revelation 5. So if you would turn in your Bibles to the last book of the Bible, Revelation chapter 5. As I was preparing this particular section, I was trying to think about what verses I could pull out from chapter 5. I'd love to say I apologize for reading the entire chapter, but I'll never apologize for reading scripture at church. We're going to read the entire chapter because this is so good. Because if we really want to put our minds around God's name being hallowed, His kingdom come, His will be done on earth as it is in heaven. If you want to start to put our mind around what that means is, what's going on in heaven, we have to read all of chapter 5, probably the whole book of Revelation, but I'm merciful. Revelation chapter 5. These are all scenes we can wrap our minds around, I believe. Then I saw on the right hand of Him who was seated on the throne a scroll written within and on the back, sealed with seven seals, and I saw a mighty angel proclaiming with a loud voice, "Who is worthy to open the scroll and break its seals?" No one in heaven or on earth or under the earth was able to open the scroll or to look into it. The Apostle John speaking here, he says, verse 4, "And I began to weep loudly because no one was found worthy to open the scroll or to look into it. And one of the elders said to me, 'Weep no more.'" Love that. Oh, heaven. "Weep no more. Behold, the Lion of the tribe of Judah, the Root of David, has conquered so that He can open the scroll and its seven seals. And between the throne and the four living creatures and among the elders, I saw a Lamb standing as though it were had been slain." Stop there for a minute. A Lamb standing as though it had been slain. I've never slaughtered an animal before, outside of a few with my car. Slain animals don't stand. Thanks be to God, the Lamb of God, who takes away the sins of the world, was slain but is standing in victory because death could not hold Him. It's one of my favorite parts, chapter 5. I saw a Lamb standing as though it had been slain. And with seven horns and with seven eyes, we get a little bit, use your imagination. With seven horns and seven eyes, which are the seven spirits of God, sent out into all the earth. And He went and took the scroll from the right hand of Him who was seated on the throne. And when He had taken the scroll, the four living creatures and the 24 elders fell down before the Lamb. Each holding a harp and a golden bowl, and golden bowls of incense, which are the prayers of the saints. And they sang a new song. "Worthy are You to take the scroll and to open its seals. For You were slain, and by Your blood You ransomed people for God from every tribe and language and people and nation. And You have made them a kingdom and priests to our God, and they shall reign," where? "On the earth." Then I looked and I heard around the throne and the living creatures and the elders the voice of many angels numbering myriads of myriads and thousands of thousands saying with a loud voice, "Worthy is the Lamb who was slain to receive power and wealth and wisdom and might and honor and glory and blessing." And I heard every creature in heaven and on earth and under the earth and in the sea and all that is in them saying, "To Him who sits on the throne and to the Lamb be blessing and honor and glory and might forever and ever." And the four living creatures said, "Amen." And the elders fell down and worshiped. In heaven, there is a true recognition of the cost of admission. "Worthy are You, O slain Lamb. Slain for me." And if we just hang out there for a second, if we remember what Jesus, how He's described as He appears post-resurrection to His disciples, what does He say to those questioning if it's really Him? "Look at the wounds on my hands. Put your hand a hole in my side." That's a slain lamb standing because death could not hold Him. Sin could not bring Him down. And in heaven, we will have some form of reminder that He paid it all. And we are only there because we are recipients of His mercy and grace, objects of His love, undeservedly so. That scene, as Revelation 5 rolls out before us, that scene will take place at some time in the closing of the age that is right now. And if we pass away and we're there at that time, you will actually see this take place. That's amazing to me. Like, we are given an actual glimpse into heaven, in heaven as it is on earth, of what it means to have his name be hallowed, to see and to desire for his kingdom to come, to be the ruler over my heart in this world, and to see his will be done. So if we want to put legs around what does it look like in heaven, it's that undivided obedience to the Lord. Namely, because they're free from the effects of sin that you and I still battle today. We're not capable of that here. And that's where that dissonance comes in. That's where it's like, I know what God's will is, but doggone it, I kind of want mine right now. That's where that dissonance comes in, where we say, I can't even more strongly desire to be free from sin. Maybe you have a particular temptation that plagues you, a hound that howls at you at night, a plaguing, pesky sin. And you want it gone, and that's a good desire. That's where that dissonance comes in. You're like, ah, I want this gone. Keep fighting. Keep struggling, keep battling, keep going to war. Keep seeking to be more and more like Christ. Because one day, you won't wear armor. You'll be prepared for a banquet. You'll be prepared for a feast. I can't wait for that day. One day, from heaven, a city will come down, given to us in vision form again in Revelation. I love this. When we think about the different ways heaven is described, we see that there's going to be a city coming down. We see that in Revelation 21. So if you're in Revelation, you can turn over to 21. Beginning in verse 1, then I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and the sea was no more. And I saw the holy city, New Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, behold, the dwelling place of God is with man. I mean, this is Emmanuel playing out in final, consummated heavenly form. Thanks be to God for that day. He will dwell with them, and they will be his people, and God himself will be with them as their God. He will wipe away every tear from their eyes, and death shall be no more. Neither shall there be mourning, nor crying, nor pain anymore, for the former things have passed away. Verse 5, and he who is seated on the throne said, behold, I am making all things new. Oh, start with my heart, Lord. Also he said, write this down, for these words are trustworthy and true. And he said to me, it is done. Can I ask you something? Is there any variation in that sentence? Maybe I'm alone here, but I don't live like that all the time. It is done. I am the Alpha, the beginning. I am the Omega. I am the beginning and the end. To the thirsty I will give from the spring of the water of life without payment. The one who conquers will have this heritage, and I will, by the way, conquer, that doesn't mean like the one who just skates by. No, that's battle. That's fight sin imagery. The one who conquers will have this heritage, and I will be his God, and he will be my son. But as for the cowardly, the faithless, the detestable, as for the murderers, the sexually immoral, sorcerers, idolaters, and all liars, their portion will be in the lake that burns with fire and sulfur, which is the second death. And I ask myself when I read through that verse 8, and I think to myself, well, who's left? He names a lot of people. The faithless, the cowardly, well, I've been there. The detestable, murderers, I was fine until Jesus preached on it in the Sermon on the Mount and says that you can be unjustly angry, I'm guilty. Sexually immoral, if you lust with your heart, you're guilty of adultery. Sorcerers, idolaters, I've had all of that in my life. Liars, I've gotten pretty good on that one. Oh wait, nope, there's another one, a lie. Their portion will be the lake of the lake that burns with fire and sulfur, which is the second death. And I think to myself, woe is me. God says, you're right. And he takes Jesus, untouched by sin. The tongs of holiness lived in this world, received scorn and shame, sometimes from his own family, sometimes from his own disciples, not just Judas, we pick on him a lot. We received rejection from the world around him, the earthly powers, the rulers of his day, because apparently that's where our hope resides, is in rulers of this world. Pity them. They don't rule anything. They're supposed to rule for God. Systems of justice failed him. His disciples turned their backs. The entire populace, which was singing his praise days before, says, give us Barabbas. And upon the altar of God, cursed is all who hang on a tree, was the perfect one who died. Didn't stay that way. On the third day, as promised, because God's promises never fail, he vacated that tomb, defeating all temptations, defeating all the temptations of Satan, who even tried to use God's word to tempt Jesus to sin. Defeating death itself, rose from the grave, showing that he is the Lord of life, the Alpha and the Omega, and then offers you salvation and bids you come, not of any works of yourself, because he is the coal by which you are made not guilty and your sins are atoned for. He's the coal that can say to every single person, no matter what title you put on them, that repents and puts their trust in Jesus Christ, is brought into heaven forever. That includes the cowardly, that includes the faithless, that includes the detestable, that includes the murderers, the sexually immoral, the sorcerers, the idolaters, and the liars. I got everybody in the room. I already know that. That net's huge. He says, come, because as Paul writes in 1 Corinthians, such were some of you. You've been washed. You've been made new by the precious blood of Jesus Christ. That's how you will be in heaven, falling down in perfect obedience, worshiping him and fulfilling whatever role he gives you to do. Because it's not going to be boring in heaven. In fact, if you want a harp, I bet you he'll have one. I don't. But maybe in my perfect will, I want a harp. I don't know. We'll have roles. We'll have things to do. We'll have worship to offer, because it'll all be worship to him. It'll be the Garden of Eden par excellence. We will guard. We will work. We will do everything to worship the king, and we will never have to hide from him and try to cover ourselves with false ways to forgive ourselves, because we will be forgiven. Perfect. Sinless, with no temptations. Offering praise to him. It'll be a city where all of those like-minded people, which are Christ-minded people, will dwell and will inhabit. We see that second analogy for heaven, which is called a banquet. We could turn to Matthew 8 or we could turn to Luke 22, but since we're in Revelation, I want to read from Revelation 19. I made it easy on you guys. Revelation 19 reads, and the angel said to me, write this. Blessed are those who are invited to the marriage supper of the Lamb. And he said to me, these are the true words of God. And I fell down at his feet to worship him. But he said, you must not. I'm a fellow servant with you. Worship God. 21 and a half years ago, Kathy and I got married, and we didn't send out a save the date. That's the thing now, right? You save the date, and then you get the invitation later. I think that's a ploy of the post office. Here's your save the date. Here's your save the date. You are invited to the marriage supper of the Lamb, where you will feast on heavenly goodness forevermore. And I don't know what food's going to be there. Quite frankly, I don't care if there is food. There probably will be, but quite frankly, I don't care, because I will feast on having a heart free from sin and temptation. I will feast on having perfect fellowship with all of you that are there. I will feast in being able to see Jesus with my spiritual eyes before me and see him face to face. I hope there's not atrophy in heaven, because I don't know if my eyes will move off of him the first 10,000 years. Like, I hope when, after 10,000 years, if my eyes can move from him, I don't get like a headache. Like, oh, that hurt. There's more people here. I've been enamored with you, Jesus, the one who took away my sins, the one who took me, destined for hell, and transplanted me and made me an alien of righteousness in heaven, who cloaked me and covered me with his love and his mercy and his kindness. Because we will feast, there will be a banquet. I think David might be the DJ. He was good with music. Everyone will dance but the Baptists. Sorry, Earl and Joyce. We will be forever in the presence of the Lord our King. Joy evermore. Oh, so good. And there's that final analogy. We're going to go back to Hebrews that Sharon read for us. Hebrews 12. Where there's mountains, and I love this. I had Sharon begin reading in the part about Mount Zion, but I want you to hear in Hebrews 12, verse 18, there's a mountain that's first compared to the mountain of Zion, and that is Mount Sinai, we can safely say. Verse 18, you have not come to what may be touched, a blazing fire and darkness and gloom and a tempest, and the sound of a trumpet and a voice whose words made the hearers beg that no further messages be spoken to them. He's talking about Mount Sinai, by the way. This is all Moses getting the Ten Commandments language. He's saying, you haven't been called to that. Verse 20, for they could not endure the order that was given. If even a beast touches the mountain, it shall be stoned. Indeed, so terrifying was the sight that Moses said, I tremble with fear. The law drives us to our need for forgiveness. The law serves a purpose. The law is a servant of God. It tells us that we are sinful and we need forgiveness, and we can't even come to the mountain of God, let alone touch it. There's a different mountain. There's Mount Zion. You have come. Oh, the contrast is so good. Verse 22, you have come to Mount Zion and to the city of the living God, the heavenly Jerusalem. Sound familiar? And to innumerable angels in festal gatherings. Sound familiar? And to the assembly of the firstborn who are enrolled in heaven. And to God, the judge of all. And to the spirit of the righteous made perfect. That's all good. That's all amazing. That's all, like, that's pretty cool. Then verse 24, and to Jesus, the sole single mediator of a new covenant, and to the sprinkled blood that speaks a better word than the blood of Abel. Brothers and sisters, you've come to the mountain of grace by the precious blood of Jesus Christ. To the heavenly Jerusalem. That is where God's name is forever and perfectly hallowed. I won't get upset when I hear blasphemy in heaven. Because if I hear Jesus Christ, it'll be because they're looking at the King. That is where his kingdom will have already come. And we as his love, objects of his love, his royal subjects, will see him as the majesty that he deserves. And that is where his full will, his desirous will to give us good things as demonstrated in creation, will be fully demonstrated. That's on earth as it is in heaven. And that's only because of the precious blood of Jesus Christ. That's your save the date. Come to Jesus and receive life, forgiveness. You can go from woe is me to RSVP. I'm there. Thank you, Jesus. You can fall on your knees and with empty hands confess that I am lost without you. I have no hope except for that second death that Revelation warns me about. That's what my sins deserved. But Father, I know you can wash me clean. Lord, do it and do it today. that's heaven on earth, until it is. Let's pray.